Hello, welcome to another episode of Into Their Minds. In this season, we are focused on bringing to our viewers different perspectives to look at the current pandemic situation. Likewise, we previously had with us Dr. Vikram Patel sharing his perspective on the psychological toll of the current pandemic situation. Today, we are collaborating with Ecological Society of ISOTVM, ESI, interviewing an eminent personality to share with us his perspective of the pandemic situation. Dr. Bivash Pandev is a prominent naturalist and a wildlife scientist, faculty in the Endangered Species Department at the Wildlife Institute of India. While his doctoral research was primarily focused on marine life, particularly the discovery of the Mars sea turtle nesting sites in Odisha, his work has taken him through many diverse ecosystems. Dr. Pandev, thank you so much for finding time to talk to us today. Okay, we know you're a very busy person, so let's get started on the questions. Okay, so as many countries went into lockdown due to this pandemic, airports got shut down and people went into quarantine, there was a running narrative of how nature was healing and that humans are the virus. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, that's the, I would say that's the best thing that could have happened to nature. I mean, it's very, very unfair what happened to all of us. Life has almost, life had come to a standstill, but nature was just waiting for this rest. And what I witnessed during the lockdown or during the peak of lockdown, I was moving inside the forest and I was seeing the nature bouncing back. And I was seeing the animals getting a huge respite from all sorts of things, vehicles flying on the road, tourists entering into the forest, from the pollution that was happening in the air or in water. There was a massive, massive change, absolute peace. The sky became absolutely clear. There was no haze in the sky. And on top of it, the water of River Ganga became potable. One could drink water in one of the most polluted places like Haridwar. So that sums up the thing, that how animals got a huge, huge respite during the lockdown.
So what steps can we take going forward to keep these gains in biodiversity and low emissions?
First of all, there are a lot of policies, there are a lot of rules, there are a lot of legislations, a lot of things on paper. But most important thing is we have to be disciplined. We should all play our role in the system. If we keep thinking that government will enforce everything and all enforcement agencies, the onus is on with the enforcement agencies, then we are wrong. We should make sure that our vehicles are maintained properly, they are serviced regularly. We should ensure that we minimize the use of our vehicles or we pool our vehicles and move together. And as less carbon footprint as possible, leave it in this world. It's not possible. It's not possible. We have to fly between cities. We have to move on the highways in good vehicles. We have to switch on the air conditioner that will emit a lot of gas. But we can always minimize it. We can build up a lot of green covers in our surroundings so that at least the micro climate or the temperature in a small area we can control. So a lot of things are in our hand. It's not that we cannot. Even simply by when we are leaving the room, switching up the light or switching up the fan, switching up the AC, that itself contributes. Imagine million people or billion people in this country start following these things. That will have a major, major impact other than whatever set procedures, rules, regulations and legislations are there. So it's most of the things are in our hand. How responsibly we behave, how responsible citizen we can be, it all depends on us.
Okay. So, sir, one thing this pandemic has made painfully obvious is that we are more connected across the globe than ever before. We've had a coronavirus outbreak in every decade of the century. Does the increased connectivity of the world come at the cost of being more vulnerable to such epidemics?
Uh, Well, I would say that's the best thing that has happened to all of us, that we have certainly become more and more connected. And the other thing that has the biggest benefit of this epidemic has been it has cut our travel time in a major way. For example, for me, to going to Delhi to attend a meeting, it was taking one day, leave Dehradun early in the morning, go to Delhi, attend the meeting, either come back in the night or come back next day morning, just for 1 hour or 2 hour meeting. I can conduct 4 or 5 meetings in a day sitting here in my office without even going to Delhi. So in a major way, the carbon footprint of my travel, of my stay, or the other things associated with it has been largely minimized. And we are able to function in a much more efficient manner rather than running around or wasting a lot of time. So I think that could have been the best thing that has happened during this pandemic. And the other thing that has happened during the pandemic, I would say the quality of life has certainly increased. The quality of air we are breathing has gone up. The quality of water we are drinking has become better. So, and I would say, I mean, definitely people have fallen sick, but I would say more and more people, by breathing fresh air, by drinking good water, I mean, we have increased our lifespan. Just imagine people living in Delhi or in nearby cities, Gurgaon or Noida, how much of polluted air they were inhaling, and 3-4 months of pure air they could inhale. So that has definitely increased their lifespan for those during those 3-4 months. So I would say that's the biggest plus point amidst this gloomy situation during the pandemic.
Dr. Pandey, many of the human activities have contributed to this pandemic also fits into the broader context of climate change. Effects of climate change is evident as every passing year seems to set a new record for heat waves, violent hurricanes, and glacier melts. We have known some of the causes for such changes for decades. Yet the way to address these issues has been a quagmire of politics and vested interest. What are those things that we should be doing both individually and as communities to bring about a greater impact?
I think we know very well by now that climate change is a reality. There is no running away from this truth. And most of the problems that we're facing, the unseasonal rains, the cyclones, the kind of floods that are happening in some of the major river systems of our country, or for that matter, you look at Kerala, what's happening, the havoc during monsoon. It's all related to some way or the other related to climate change. And also the way we have started our development activities, like the haphazard way human beings have tried settling down everywhere, it further accelerates the damage. So once again, as I have told earlier, we got to behave in as responsible manner as possible. We have to be very, very responsible citizens. We have to minimize our carbon footprints at every single step we take. Unless we discipline ourselves, unless that self-discipline creeps into our day-to-day life, we just cannot fight this massive problem of climate change. And as a country, one of the second most populous country in this world, we have a big responsibility in mitigating this problem. I understand that the developed countries have much more or contribute in a big way to the greenhouse emission, but that doesn't undermine that we should not play our role. Behave as responsibly as possible, minimize your carbon footprints, and try to lead a simple life. That's the key. That's the key to fight with climate change.
So the Wildlife Institute of India has been your home for nearly 3 decades. You did your MSc, PhD, and are currently the faculty there. So what was your reaction to the recently proposed funding cuts to certain environmental agencies, including the Wildlife Institute of India, in the union budget? Is it yet another indication of the priorities of the government, or is it an inevitable part of the shrunken economy due to this pandemic?
I presume this is not a final decision yet. The government has expressed its desire to make the Wildlife Institute of India fully autonomous body, but I understand that we are not at a position to leave without the grant from the government, and we are making an appeal to the government justifying our stand. And I hope Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change takes a favorable stand to our appeal, and the decision can be, or the recommendation can be reversed, and we continue to be very much part of this government.
Yes, sir. So wildlife tourism has become a great business model to boost conservation. Is there any other approach that can achieve the same, involving all kinds of stakeholders, including the local communities, that can improve both the environment and their standard of living?
I completely beg to differ with the current model of wildlife tourism. The current model of wildlife tourism is making the rich more richer and the poor continue to live the way they are living at the moment. The local people are not benefiting much with the current model of wildlife tourism. So what I say that wildlife tourism, the bulk of the revenue generated from wildlife tourism, other than the government revenue, bulk of the money goes to private owners, especially the hoteliers and the tour operators. And local people continue to do menial jobs in the hotels and resorts near protected areas. That has to be complete. That has to be changed. Small country like Nepal has shown us the way. 50% of money generated from the wildlife tourism goes to the communities living in the buffer zone of the area. So places like Chitwan, Bardia and Suklapanta, where directly from the revenue generated from wildlife, there need to be greater involvement of local people, and they should be the primary stakeholders. As far as possible, homestay should be encouraged, and community-based tourism should be operated, and major players should take a back seat, and more local people should come forward and be the front runner as far as wildlife tourism is concerned. The current model of wildlife tourism is certainly not sustainable and is not going to benefit local communities or not going to benefit the wildlife in any way.
So, sir, could you tell us more about the research you are currently involved in at the Wildlife Institute of India?
I did my doctoral research on marine turtle for about 8 years along the coast of Orissa. Before that, I did brief work on water monitor lizard in the mangrove forests of Bhitarkanika. I did work on colonial nesting birds in the mangrove forests in Orissa. Then subsequently, I continued with a very long-term monitoring of recovery of tiger and prey population in the Himalayan foothills in the state of Uttarakhand. Then I have been working in central India, in the states of Chhattisgarh, primarily on human-elephant conflict. At the moment, working on human-elephant conflict in Uttarakhand, and working on the movement and inbreeding status of swamp deer, and sort of tend to work on a wide variety of animals and birds.
Okay. I think that's all. Thank you, Dr. Pandya, for an insightful discussion and sharing your thoughts on the current situation. We were very glad to have you here. Thank you.
Thank you.